God, thank you so much for the opportunity to come worship you in the ways that we know how. And we are able to use the talents you give us, and that's incredible. And thank you for being here with us, the creator of the universe. And the fact that you're here and your spirit is here with us this morning is amazing. Thank you so much for that. I pray that you are blessed by what you hear and what you see this morning. And I pray that everyone here knows they're not here by accident, that they're here for a reason. They're here to hear from you this morning. Hear our prayer. Amen.
Water that turned into wine, open me. please join with me in scripture reading. We read scripture here weekly with a specific purpose, and that's because we believe that the Bible is God's written word, and that's how we communicate with him. It sparks that communication. And if we can read his words and put it into action into our lives and in a relationship with him, it makes all the difference in the world. So if you'll please join me. 1 Chronicles 16:23-29. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and he is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his place. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time and this opportunity and the freedoms that we have to be here in this place worshiping you. Lord, thank you that our hope is in you. And thank you that we're redeemed because we believe in you and we love you and that you love us. And I just pray that you can open the ears of the people today that they can hear what you want them to hear. And I just pray that you can be with Rusty as he brings the message and gives you glory in that. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
offering and tithes and giving. And y'all can have a seat if you'd like to, please. Chris mentioned earlier the card, the Connect card we have for first-time guests. If you're a first-time guest, really we would like you to take that out to the First Impressions or Guest Services Desk. We have a great gift for you. Just a token of our appreciation for you coming today. He didn't mess up on one slight thing. He said we wouldn't knock on your door at dinner. That depends on if you put "watch for dinner" on that card. You put "watch for dinner" on that card, I may knock. Okay. We'll see. But if there's nothing listed for dinner, then no, we won't knock. Our tithes and offering is a really, really big deal here at the Ridge. We take it very seriously, and we understand it's a big deal because it's a way that we can show outwardly our expression of love to others. We're called to show Christ's love to others. And that's what a good portion of that tithes and offerings go to. I hope you never take it for granted or never seem to think that the lead team just writes checks or whatever. I mean, we take it very seriously being stewards, good stewards of the tithes and offerings that come in. And we want to use that as much as we possibly can to show God's love to others. So with that, let's pray. Bobby's out of town this weekend attending a wedding. He'll be back next weekend, and he will attempt to clean up the mess that I made today. Good luck to him. And he may have a challenge on his hands. I have been told that whenever I speak, that two things generally happen. One, I ruffle feathers, and two, I make people cry. I may not make you cry today. The ruffled feathers is probably going to happen. That's just your fair warning, okay? That's just your fair warning. This is probably coming. So let's just jump right into this. The red and blue. How do we get through the political season as a Christian? How many of you love the political season? You love the drama. You love the speeches. You love the debates, the commercials, just all of it. How many of you just, it's a great time of the year for you? A couple. Not many. A few. That's good. I mean, we'll have you come down after the service, and we'll gather around you and pray for you to heal you of that affliction. How many of you are like me? You're over it already. You're done. Bad news. It's still 72 days till the election. 72 more days. And let's be real. It's not going to stop there, right? I mean, even after the election, that's just when the wailing and gnashing of teeth begins. Apparently, half of you won't be here anymore because everybody on each side is going to, if the other one gets elected, I'm moving to another country. So half of you are going to be gone. So I got 72 days to enjoy your company before somebody leaves. Okay? Hopefully you won't do that. Hopefully you'll be here the whole time regardless, and we'll go from there. Okay? So let's take a look at some stuff. Part of our problem is that our culture, our political culture, to me anyway, is just confusing. It's just confusing, regardless of which side you're on. It's just confusing. Let me give you an example. Conservatives. Conservatives say that we are pro-life. And then we turn around and say, we're pro-death penalty. That seems to conflict. And liberals say, I'm pro-choice, but not when it comes to choice about maybe own something like owning a gun. So maybe are we choice or are we not choice? Are we life or we not life? Or we, it can get, at the best, it can get confusing. Okay? At the very best, it can get confusing. Here's the most personal question I'm going to ask you all day. Well, maybe. How many of you already have it in your head that regardless of what happens between now and November 8th, you know who you're going to vote for? I don't want to know who. I just want to. How many of you have already figured, okay, this is the way I'm going? I'm voting this way. Okay.
I've struggled. How many of you are like me, and every time you think about our current political situation, you go, really? Really? Millions of people, and this is all we can come up with? And the more you think about it, you have those OCMs. For those of you who don't know what that is, that's an oh crap moment when you realize you're 72 days and we got to figure something out, right? I've narrowed it down to two, okay? I've got it down, not the two you're thinking about. I've got it down to two. I'm not sure. I'm a waffle between these two, okay? Here's one of my choices right now. I'm really feeling that one right now, to be honest. I mean, you know. And then my other choice that I'm really struggling with, if I don't go with this one, for those of you that don't know, those are the two lead characters off The Walking Dead. I haven't decided. Hopefully in the next 72 days, I'll make a decision there, okay? I will tell you this. You do need to mark your calendars for the week of September 24th. September 24th is going to be a great, great entertainment week, that week, okay? September 24th. University of Tennessee plays University of Florida in football. That's going to be a good day. Yeah, that's going to be a good day. 2 days later, on September 26th, is the first presidential debate. Now, it's a toss-up. Which one of those two events is going to have the most head-banging and trash-talking? Okay? It could be close. Could be close. Great entertainment week, though. Mark those. Here's another question for you. Who thinks that churches shouldn't even talk about politics? This is a subject that shouldn't even be brought up in church. How many of you? Just a few? Okay, a few. And you're here. I'm proud of you. I'm glad you're here. And you haven't run for the door yet. I'm even more proud of you that you haven't cut out yet. Okay? That's good. Just hang in there. I've got a challenge for you today. But here's the problem with the challenge. I truly don't think that most Christians are up to this challenge. I just don't think they're up to it. Now, the difference is, I think the rich church is. I think we are up to it because we are way more jacked up than most churches, and because of that, I think that we can pull off things that other churches can't pull off. And so I think you're going to be able to pull this off, but it won't be easy. It won't be easy at all. Here's the challenge. As Christians, I want to challenge you from now until November 8th, 72 days, to put your faith first and your politics second. Got that? From now until November 8th, to put your faith first and your politics second. To put your faith filter in front of your political filter. To put your faith ahead of you being a Republican, or put your faith ahead of you being a Democrat, or put your faith ahead of you being a Libertarian or Independent or whatever. To put your Christ follower values first and your political values second. If for no other reason, if you can't think of a good reason to do that, if for no other reason than this, nobody goes to Washington, D.C. when they die. Right? Now, I will admit, from my point of view, Washington, D.C., hell. Pretty close. But let's face it, hell is even a whole lot worse, okay? If I can get my mind wrapped around that. Hell is a whole lot worse than Washington, D.C. And so that's just one more reason not to put your politics ahead of your faith. Now, some of you aren't really sure you can do that, especially if you're really passionate about your political views. You may not be real sure that you can pull that off. But I'm sure that you can, and here's another reason why. At any given time in our lives, at any moment in our lives, something can happen that no matter how passionate we are about our political views, something can happen that make all our, that goes backstage, back door, that goes away. Our political views now become irrelevant because we have this issue that we have to deal with. And in those times of crisis, it's our faith that serves us to the front, right? We can put our faith ahead of our politics. some of you have been in the same situation. I've been there a few times where I'm spending someone's last moments of their life here on earth with them. And no matter how passionate they were about their politics, not once, not a single time have I been in that situation where as things were winding down for them here on this earth, somebody has looked at me and said, Rusty, you know, I don't have much time left. Would you please, please, just read some to me from the Constitution? Hasn't happened, right? Or how about the Bill of Rights? That means so much to me. When you read through the Bill of Rights, it's just the last thing I want to hear. No, nobody ever says that. Nobody ever says it. So again, we need to keep our focus on faith first, politics second. Because we know that our faith is far more important. Now, before I go any further, let me make sure we understand some things that I'm not saying. Okay? Because this is one of those messages that, yeah, you can hear what I'm saying, but it's really easy to go and sort of think that I'm saying some things that I'm not. Okay? So let's make sure we're clear on what I'm not saying. Here are a few things. I'm not saying that you shouldn't have an opinion. You should have an opinion. Okay? You should have an opinion. It's okay to have an opinion. My daughter has informed me that I have an opinion about everything. I can't really argue with that. But she also informed me that some people don't have opinions about everything and they're just fine with that. Who knew? I didn't even know that was possible. But apparently some people are fine without having opinions. And if you're one of them, great. But if you have an opinion, that's okay. Here's something else I'm not saying. I'm not saying that we will, or for that matter, that we even should agree on everything. And I'm not saying that as Christians that we should vote for any particular candidate or even, to that matter, lean into any particular political party. I'm not saying any of those things, okay? I am saying that you should put your faith before your politics. Another quick question for you. Is there anyone that I haven't offended yet? Haven't offended you yet? A few. That's okay. I'll get you. We got time. Bear with me. I got plenty of time to go. Now, some of you are sitting there going, Rusty, I'm glad you're talking about this. These other people need to hear all about this. Most of us think that we have this down, right? We think that we have it down. And we don't see any conflict between our faith and our politics. Matter of fact, a lot of you would tell me that your reason for your political views is your faith. That's where you get your political views from. Let's take a look at this. For example, let's say you're a Republican. And Republicans are sitting there going, okay, but faith is why I am a Republican. I mean, let's face it, Rusty. I mean, come on now. I mean, God is always right. Jesus is always right. I'm right. If you got all this right, you got to be on the right. Yeah, see? That was supposed to do. That was supposed to be a Republican because it's the right thing. Or you throw this out there and you go, what about Matthew? Jesus picked Matthew to be a disciple, to be one of his 12. Matthew was a tax collector. What was another word, another name for tax collectors? Publicans. See, it's practically right there in the Bible. I mean, Jesus even picked Republicans or publicans. I said, yeah, come on. And now Democrats are going to come on. You got to be kidding me, right? You got to be kidding me. Let's face it. Jesus was a healthcare dispensing machine, right? A machine. Everywhere he went, he gave free healthcare. People lined up for hours. He never charged them a thing. He never turned anybody away. Come on. And at least twice in the Bible, we have examples or documentation where he gave away food to the masses free. He's got to be a Democrat, Rusty. Come on. And libertarians are going, whoa, not so fast. Not so fast. I mean, let's face it. The scripture that politicians, although they butcher it and misquote it, take it out of context, but probably the most often quoted scripture by politicians comes out of John 8:32. You know it. You can fill in the blank, right? And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you Free! Free! Is it liberated? Libertarians are gone. There it is. And what about Paul? Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians, his first letter to the church in Thessalonians, he said, ready for this? Work hard with your own hands and mind your own business. Libertarians are going, right there it is. Done. It's sealed. Supposed to be a libertarian. So what about now? Have I offended everybody now? Got everybody now? Anybody left? Anybody left? I'll get you. We're still. It's coming. You'll get to be in the club. Okay? Here's the point. When it comes to putting your faith before your politics, it doesn't work to say, and just bear with me on this one, okay? Hear me out. It doesn't work to say, I'm going to put the Bible before my politics. I'm going to put what the Bible says before my politics. And it doesn't even work well for us when we say, I'm going to put what Jesus said above my politics. And here's why, okay? Because we all run things through our own filter. We all run things through our own filter. I can go in the Bible and I can find things to support at least some part of my political view, whatever my political view may be. I can find something in the Bible to do that. I can find something that Jesus said that when I run it through my own filter, I can say, yeah, this supports my political values, my political stance. It supports that. So it's not good enough to say that, well, what the Bible says or what Jesus said, I'm asking you to put your faith before your politics. Okay? Putting your faith before your politics. When it comes to politics, we all want Jesus to be on our side. Make sure you understand this. Jesus didn't come to take sides. Jesus came to take over. He didn't come to take sides. He came to take over. For us to get this right, and we can get it right. And as Christians, we have to get this right. And we have the opportunity for the next few months, for the next 72 days, to get this right. In order for us to get this right, it requires more than reading the Bible. It requires more than reading what Jesus said. It requires that we approach the topic the way that Jesus approached everything. In other words, to get this right, we actually have to do something that Jesus did. Jesus did one thing specifically and consistently throughout his entire ministry. And it's so simplistic. The way we keep our faith first and our politics second is that we put people first and politics second. Jesus was for what was best for people. Now that, what was for what was best for people. It's a common ground that we can have as citizens, it's a common ground that we can have as Christians, and it's a common ground that we can have with our Heavenly Father. Another way to say it would be this. We can disagree, and we will, and we probably should disagree at times about what is actually best for people, about the actual thing, maybe about a bill or a policy or an issue or something like that. We're probably going to disagree with that, and that part's okay. But what we cannot disagree about is that what is best is what is best for people. We can't disagree with that. It's a common theme through the New Testament, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God so loved the world, you, me, all of us. He loved us so much that he did what was best for us and gave his only Son. Another way to look at it would be this. Another example was, God did not create people for the law. He created the law for the people. Got that? He didn't create people for the law. He created the law for people. Check out this story. There's a story in Matthew chapter 22, verses 34 and 40. Check this out. It says, but when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And he said to them, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Let's take a look at the story a little bit. So here are the religious leaders, the Pharisees. They come after Jesus. They're going to try to outsmart the Son of God. Not a real smart thing to do, but they thought they were that smart. And the Sadducees, which were another group of religious leaders, Jesus had already shot them down. They tried the same thing. He shot them down. So the Pharisees said, okay, that's the Sadducees. We got it. So they come, and one of them is a lawyer, so he asked him this question. Of all the laws, now in the Old Testament, there were over 600 laws, right? Over 600 laws. He's like, of all those 600 laws, Jesus, you claim to be close to God. You claim to know God really well. But tell me, which one is the one? And they're hoping to trap him here. And Jesus, without any hesitation, apparently goes, well, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. And the second is like it, to love your neighbor as yourself. Now, you got to pay attention right here, because this is so, so big. If he would have just stopped with that first one, okay? To love the Lord our God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. If he would have just stopped right there, it would have been a whole different story. That leaves some wiggle room, doesn't it? How can I look at you and tell what's in your mind? How can I look at you and tell that you love the Lord our God with all your mind, or all your heart, or all your soul? How can I tell that? I mean, almost every politician claims they love God. How can we look at a politician and go, no, they don't. No, I can see what's in their heart. No, you can't. I can see what's in their soul. No, we can't. Or even what's in their mind. We can't. So there would have been a lot of wiggle room right there if Jesus had just stopped it. But he didn't stop. He, before the Pharisees could even take a breath and come after him, he said, and. Love the Lord, or love your neighbor like you love yourself. And I love little words that carry a big punch. And this is a little word that's easy to blow by, that it carries such a big punch. And means it's equal to. Not if, not or, not but. And. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. And the second one is just like it. It's just as important as the first one. Love your neighbor like yourself. That puts a whole different spin on it. In other words, we could say it like this. Love God on the inside and demonstrate it on the outside. Love God on the inside and demonstrate it on the outside. How do we demonstrate our love for God? By how we treat people. By loving them the way we want to be loved. He went on and he even said all the laws and everything spoken by the prophets depends on these two commandments. In other words, he's saying, if you don't remember anything else, if you don't get anything else, if you don't know any of the other 600 laws, if you don't know anything else, no matter how jacked up your life is, no matter how tough things are going for you, no matter what kind of situation you've been in the past or you're in now, remember this, love the Lord our God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind. And love your neighbor like you love yourself. How do you put your faith before your politics? By how you treat people. Now really when it comes down to it, it's profoundly simple. It really is simple. And a lot of times we want to make this a whole lot more complicated than what it is. I don't know if we want to do it because it makes us feel smart or what, but we really want to throw in a lot of things and make it complex and complicated, and it's just so simple. So simple. Imagine what would happen if every single person in our country, in the United States, for the next 72 days, between now and November 8th, treated everyone else like they wanted to be treated themselves. If they loved every other person they came in contact with, if they loved that person the way that we want to be loved ourselves. Imagine what kind of change that would be in our country. Christians, if you're today and you're not a Christian, you get a free pass and just sit back and relax and enjoy it. But Christians, we don't get that pass, right? We don't get that pass. This is what we're called to do. What if just Christians did this? What if just the people sitting in church services this morning across our country said, you know what? This is what God said to do. He said it's really, really important. As a matter of fact, Jesus said it's the most important thing. Love my God with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, and to love others, to love my neighbors like I love myself. Boom, I'm sold, I'm in. That's what I'm going to do. Imagine what our country would look like. Imagine what Oak Ridge would look like. It would be so different. Most of our laws would be irrelevant. We could keep them on the books. Nobody ever would be breaking them. We'd be too busy loving it. Now, we would have problems. We would have problems. There would be people sitting at a four-way stop going, no, you go. No, no, really, you go. No, no, you know, really, really, you go. I mean, I would like to go first. So I would like you to go first. I mean, the traffic might be a problem, okay? But what a difference our country would be if we would just do what we're called to do. When it came right down to it, it almost wouldn't matter who we elected president. If we could do that. Let's change gears for a minute. Your behavior makes perfect sense to you, right? I mean, maybe not now, but when you said, here, hold my beer and watch this, it was making perfectly good sense to you at that time, right? Perfectly good sense. Our political views make perfectly good sense to us. Well, we understand that. Let's say, you hit that time where you're talking to somebody and politics comes up and they are the exact opposite of your views. And you get to talking and discussion starts to get a little heated and then it starts to pick up and then you start to get passionate, each of you start to get passionate about your views and things are really, you don't get it. You don't understand how they could possibly believe that, how they could possibly even think it, much less believe it and promote it. You just don't get it. So how are you supposed to handle that situation? Well, it's pretty simple. You go home, you go home right away, you get on social media, and you rip them to shreds. No, you don't. Y'all are sitting there acting like, oh, he's right. No, don't. Okay? You don't do that. So what do we do? How do we handle that situation? Very simple step. You become a student, not a critic. Become a student, not a critic. You get to those points, and I really hope this isn't talking to you, but if you already think that you know everything about a political view or about whatever, if you think that there's no need for you to be a student, there's no need for you to learn anything, if you've already got it, you already know everything. And bottom line is, you're arrogant and insecure. My mother, when I was a senior in high school and hit that phase where I thought I knew everything, had a saying. She would look at me and go, Rusty, between the two of us, we know everything there is to know. You apparently know everything except that you're a fool, and I know that. If we think we know it all, then we are arrogant and insecure. Not a good place to be in. The political season, it's a time to learn. It's a time where we can learn a lot, right? Where if we're a student first and a critic second. Here's another example. Come November 8th, tons of people will go vote, right? And if you've ever watched an election, all the news media is there, and they're interviewing people when they come out from voting, right? Well, who did you vote for? Oh, well, I voted for this person. Really? Why'd you vote for them? Well, I think they'll be a great president or whatever. Really? Why do you think that? Crickets. And then they may say, well, I like the policies. Great, that's awesome. What are they? Which ones do you like? Well, I like healthcare. What about their healthcare policy do you like? They don't know it. And it's not one side or one party or the other. It's straight across the board. People all, we vote and we don't have any idea. It's a great season to be a student, including learning why that other person thinks the way they do, even though it doesn't match up with your thoughts. Be a student first and a critic second. Some of us need to put that on every mirror that we have. We need to put it on the bathroom mirror. We need to put it on the car mirror. We need to put it everywhere. Be a student first, critic second. Here's something to think about. Christians should be the most confident people on the face of the earth. Not arrogant, but confident. We're confident in our eternal salvation, right? In our eternal, our future for eternity. What happens to us after we die? We're confident that we know what's going on there, right? We're confident as Christians that we're good. We should be confident about things. We should also be compassionate. We should also be curious. We worship a God who's a God of infinite wisdom. We say we want to be closer to God, to be more like God. We don't have infinite wisdom. He does. That means in order to get closer to Him and be more like Him, we need to learn more. We always have room to learn. That's not just the stuff to support our side. That's to learn as much as we can, period. It doesn't mean that we don't have an opinion or a view or that we can't be passionate. But if you're a Christ follower, we have a responsibility. It's a responsibility what we've been called to do and called to be. Let me give you four applications here, four practical applications. Okay? So let's say you get into these discussions with somebody and things aren't going well. It's starting to get heated. You're starting to get mad. They're starting to get mad. You're losing respect for them. It's your neighbor. You go back in, tell your husband, "Wife, well, we got to move." I mean, they believe that. Neighborhood shop. We got to move. Well, I can't live somebody next to that. You know, when things really start to get heated, here's a question you can ask. Okay, a question you can ask: what made you to that view? Okay, that's what you believe. Cool. Why? How did you get to that point of believing that? What was your process? What was your process? What does, what do you think that looks like in real life? Okay, yeah, it's the bill, and yeah, but when they implement it, I mean, what's that really going to look like? Ask them. And it's a really important question, okay? Because here's why it's so important. You just invited them, you just told them that you want to know their story. You want to know their story. You've invited them to share their story with you. Because here's the deal. When somebody says, "I'm going to vote for whoever," or "I think that, this on this issue," or "this on this issue," what you're really getting is the last sentence in a very long discussion that got them to that point. It's like you're getting the caboose of the train, not the rest of the train. You're getting that one little snippet, and that's it. Back up, invite them to share their story. And how did you get to that? Because here's something else we know. When you get to know somebody's story, it's really hard to dislike most people once you get to know their story, once you get to know their context. It's hard to not like them. Doesn't mean you have to agree with them. But now it's not a like you or I don't like you thing. And you're inviting them in. Okay? You get to the end and you may go, "Wow, that's fascinating." You may even get to the end and go, "Wow, I really kind of find that offensive." But invite them to share that part with you. A second question. Have you always held that view? Have you always held that view? Have you always voted like that? Have you ever been on the other side? Have you ever seen things from the other side? But something caused you to switch viewpoints? And so what? What was that? A third question, and this one I kind of like because it can be a little on the snarky side. And if you know me, you would understand why I like that. Third question goes like this. You're talking to somebody and it gets beyond policy. It gets beyond issues. Now it gets personal about the candidate. Okay? Now they or you, or hopefully them, are taking personal shots at the candidate, character, whatever. And you listen to them, and so it goes like this. You ask me this question. Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know her? Have you all met personally? You know them personally? And of course, they're going to look at you and go, well, no. And then here's all you have to say. Oh. That's it. Oh. You do know. And you know it. Probably don't like it, but you know it. That the Bible says that we're not supposed to gossip. And even goes on to say that as Christians, anything comes out of our mouth is supposed to be to the building up of people, not the tearing down, right? Check out Ephesians 4:29. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear it. You do know that God doesn't say, okay, it's a political season. Especially it's a presidential election year. For the next 72 days, we're just going to take that whole gossip thing, that whole edification or building up thing, we're just going to put that on the shelf. You don't have to worry about that. I'll give you a pass on that for the next 72 days because I understand it's an election season. No, he doesn't. And whether it's the person that lives next door to you or somebody else you know or somebody you don't know or politicians, all fall under this realm, not just some. We're not supposed to gossip. We're supposed to build it. Fourth question. Here's one that may be big for you. Of course, if I still haven't offended you yet, then maybe this will get you in the club. It's a statement followed by a question. Okay? It goes like this. I get most of my information from the media. How about you? And they'll go, yeah, really? Me too. Okay, and then you follow it up with this. Then we're both marginally informed and we're probably both wrong. We all pretty much get our information from the same sources. And we act like we know for a fact that all that information, oh, it's got to be correct because it's got to be right because it's backing up what I say. There we go, put it through our filter again. I like what that part says. I saw a recent thing that had two different candidates had their policies listed. No, I'm sorry, had things that they had done wrong. Two columns. And you get down to the end of it and it said, you probably only read one side of this. Or you probably only read what the person you were opposed to did wrong. And you ignored the other person, the person who were forward. You ignored their errors. Oops. Oops. Truth is, chances are, in a heated debate, neither one of us really knows what we're talking about. Not near as much as what we think we do. For us to create unnecessary friction, especially relationally, around marginal information, limited information, is absolutely foolish. Those four questions hopefully will get you back inside the guardrails, back inside the boundary of being able to bring it back to a discussion, to talk about it. One of my best friends, we've been friends for over 30 years, and we have never voted for the same person in any election, to the best I can tell. Never. Locally, nationally, anywhere in between. We never argue about politics. We talk about it. We're not going to risk our relation on marginal, possibly even wrong information. Should you have an opinion? Yes, you should. Should you be passionate about your opinion? Yes, when it's appropriate. Should you make a point at the expense of influence? Absolutely not. No. No. Okay? They're so important, especially if you're a Christian. Jesus said that we're supposed to be the light of the world and the salt of the earth, right? We're called to have influence on people. Influence in the arenas where eternity is at stake. We're called to have influence in that arena. We're called to have influence to let the world know what the world is supposed to be. We're called to have influence that people have families, help families come back together. We're supposed to have influence in the realm of healing and restitution. We're supposed to have the influence to bring sons and daughters back together, husbands and wives back together. The only way to do that is through influence. Okay? And if you're going to write anything down today, write this down. Never, never, never give up influence unnecessarily. We are called as Christians to be influencers. Never, never, never give up influence unnecessarily. Not with your kids, not with your spouse, not with people you work with, people you see at the gym, people you see when you're shopping, people you pass by on the street, your neighbors, your friends, whoever. Never, never, never give up influence unnecessarily, especially over a political issue. Let me tell you why. United States of America, a country that I dearly love, I have no desire to live anywhere else in the world. There's some places I'd like to visit, but I don't want to be coming back home. Dearly love the United States of America. But the truth of the matter is, in the United States of America, your opinion, my opinion, don't count. Our opinions don't count. It's better than that. Our vote counts. November 8th, if I sit in my recliner in my living room and I have my opinion, is it going to count? No. If I get up and go vote, my vote counts. My opinion does not. Got that? So why? Why would we ever burn a relational bridge over something that doesn't even count? Some of you have been there. Some of you have stories about this where you've got into a heated argument and it burned a bridge with a friendship or maybe even a family member. And now, later on, when that person, when that guy at work, that lady at work, that friend, that family member, when they need you and they need to be able to invite you back into their life to have influence over them in a situation, they can't because you burnt that bridge over an opinion that doesn't even count. And you lost your influence. Please. Please never give up influence unnecessarily. Because as Christians, we've been called to influence the world. Never jeopardize a relationship over something political. We can disagree on what might be best for people, but we cannot disagree on what is best is what is best for people. So here's the thing. During this political season, between now and November 8th, we as Christians have an extraordinary opportunity as Christians to showcase our political diversity in a way that honors God, who's the one who made us so diverse. Whether it's in our community groups, in our churches, in school, at work, wherever we go. Wherever God chooses to put us, we have that opportunity. And if we get this right, we'll have more influence. And if we get this right, we'll actually learn something. But listen to me, Rich Church. If we get this wrong, if we don't answer this challenge, then the truth is, we will be just like most other churches. So between now and November 8th, I want you to be intentional about putting your faith first, your politics second. do this? By putting people first. Why? Because Republican or Democrat, left or right, we are all precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Let's pray. Father, we love You so much. And we thank You for blessing us with the ability to being in a country where we have the rights that we do have, where we get to vote. And we have all these opportunities. But Father, help us not to put something like our right to vote above what You've really called us to do. Help us not to get so caught up in picking an earthly leader that we fail to follow Your leadership, that we fail to follow Your commands, that we fail to follow Your policies, and how You tell us we should do things. Help us to always keep Your leadership first and earthly leadership second. Father, You always put people first. You always did what was best. Help us to follow that model. Help us to come in line with that. Help us to love You with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, and to love others as much as we love ourselves. Help us to influence this world. Help us to change this world, not by our political opinions, but by loving others. Father, take us, use us as You would. We love You. In Your Son's name.
Go and stand with us as we worship this last song. I want to let you know we also have communion up front next to the stage. If you're a believer, please feel free to come up and take part of communion as we remember the blood and the body of Jesus Christ was sacrificed for us. And like I said, just come up while we play and take communion as a family.